As you can tell from the title, this talk is going to be very treatment focused and follow very closely the published ACG treatment guidelines from 2013. These guidelines are very similar to the Shea IDSA guidelines as well as European guidelines. And I hope that at the conclusion of this talk, you all have the knowledge to take the best care of these patients. So just one quick word on epidemiology or the scope of the problem. C. difficile has actually surpassed MRSA as the most common healthcare-associated infection in the United States and accounts for over $4 billion in excess health costs. And in a recently published study from earlier this year, the CDC did active surveillance and determined that there were at least 453,000 cases and 29,000 deaths in the U.S. annually. And it's important to remember that more than a third of these were community-associated, community-acquired infections where people had had very little contact with the healthcare environment. And also in this study, the highest incidence was in people over age 65, which is still one of the biggest risk factors for C. diff infection, as well as in females. They also showed more C. difficile infections in white patients, though this may be a factor of disparities in healthcare access. So for treatment, it's easiest to really break this down by severity of infection. Mild to moderate infection, these are patients who you're mostly treating as an outpatient. They're presenting with diarrhea, not too sick. They're not volume depleted or with abdominal tenderness. In these patients, if possible, you want to discontinue the inciting antibiotic. And they can be treated first line with metronidazole. The dose is 500 milligrams 3 times a day, and the treatment course is 10 days. And this is effective in about 85% of cases. It's cheap, about $2 a day. Unfortunately, patients can be intolerant of it and complain of a lot of nausea and GI upset while on the metronidazole. In those cases, you can treat with vancomycin, 125 milligrams, 4 times a day for 10 to 14 days. You'll also use vancomycin in patients who are pregnant or breastfeeding, or patients who fail to respond after 5 to 7 days of metronidazole therapy. And that's kind of an important point. People put somebody on antibiotics and inspect them to get better immediately or within a day or two. It can often take that length of time before things start to turn around. And you still want to avoid antiperistaltic agents in these patients for risk of precipitating toxic megacolon, which is rare, but bad. So severe infection is actually pretty easy to remember. These are the defining characteristics. Patients who come in with a white count greater than 15,000, a creatinine more than 1.5 times baseline, hypoalbuminemia with an albumin less than 3, and significant abdominal tenderness. And they can have any of these features. They don't need to have all. But the leukocytosis and hypoalbuminemia are the most closely associated with poor outcomes like ICU stays, colectomy, and death. So really worry when you see these patients. And treatment of severe infection should, of course, be supportive care. It's important to continue enteral feeding because it's the enteral feeding that allows production of short-chain fatty acids in the colon that helps nourish and heal the colonocytes. In these patients, you will start with oral vancomycin. And the dose is 125 milligrams 4 times a day for 10 days. There is no evidence that using more vancomycin is better. In fact, the MIC of vanco in the colon is very high, and 125 milligrams is more than sufficient. There's no reason to extend the treatment course to 14 days if patients are better in 10 days. And we'll talk a little bit later about recurrent disease and why more antibiotics may not always be better. This is obviously more expensive than metronidazole, costing $70 to $140 a day. It's much cheaper if you compound liquid vancomycin. And one thing that you'll see pretty frequently in the hospital is when patients are on antibiotics for something else, a UTI or pneumonia, sometimes GI or infectious disease service will recommend increasing the duration of the vancomycin to kind of overlap those other antibiotics. And there's actually no evidence for doing this. If the diarrhea is better, stop the vancomycin after they complete the course of therapy. Now, complicated infection, these are patients who just look really sick. They're in the intensive care unit, they're in shock, high fevers, some may have ileus and very significant abdominal distension, very high leukocytosis or leukopenia, and end organ failure. In complicated infection, you do want to recommend CT scanning of the abdomen and pelvis. This is to assess for megacolon. I have seen perforation that was not going to respond to medical therapy, and severe colitis on CT that just sort of helps as a prognostic factor. These patients, you throw the book at them. High dose vancomycin, 500 milligrams every 6 hours. These are the patients where you add the IV flagyl. It's only the severe complicated infection. And if they have an ileus or significant abdominal distension, you don't want all of that oral vancomycin just sitting in the stomach and never making it to the colon. You need to get vancomycin into the colon as well, and you do this by using vancomycin enemas. The dose is 500 milligrams, which you dilute in 500 mLs of saline and administer every 6 hours. And you want to get a surgeon on board early in consultation. This is actually a picture of a colon that was taken out on a patient that I was consulting for who was very sick. We know that delayed intervention causes increased mortality. You only have so much time to get these patients better, and they get sicker and sicker, and then eventually kind of come off the cliff, and there's nothing that surgery is going to be able to do. A total abdominal colectomy and end ileostomy is still the procedure of choice, though the 30-day perioperative mortality with this procedure is quite high, ranging from 30 to 80%. At the University of Pittsburgh, Surgeon Neal pioneered an approach where he created a diverting loop ileostomy rather than take the colon out, and then infuses warm PEG intraoperatively to sort of wash out all the toxin. They then administer enemas via that stoma of vancomycin for 10 days. And in that series, they had only 19% mortality compared to 50% with historic controls. And there is a larger clinical trial that is in progress. So when do you really push the surgeons? Any patients who are requiring vasopressors with a lot of sepsis and organ dysfunction, you see maybe the, kind of think of the number 5, white blood cell count greater than 50,000, lactate above 5, not improving after 5 days of medical therapy, you really shouldn't let the sun set on that patient and really kind of push the surgeon about operating, which obviously they're very hesitant to do sometimes. So I just want to kind of spend one slide on this special subgroup of patients, patients with inflammatory bowel disease. So we all know hospitalized patients with inflammatory bowel disease flares require C. difficile testing. But also remember that patients who've already had a colectomy and have a surgically created pouch may develop C. diff, enteritis, or pouchitis, and they should also be tested if symptomatic and treated accordingly. And oral vancomycin was shown to be superior to metronidazole for treatment of IBD patients with moderate to severe disease. But more recently, a study this year out of Cedars-Sinai, showed decreased length of stay and readmissions in ulcerative colitis patients, and these were highly significant results. And these were patients with non-severe CDI. So a lot of IBD experts do skip metronidazole entirely in IBD patients and just go right to vancomycin in that population. So recurrent CDI, these are patients who get better with each course of vancomycin, but relapse within a couple of days to a couple of weeks of coming off the treatment regimen. And it's common, it occurs in about 20% of patients after an initial infection, and with each subsequent recurrence, your risk of further recurrence is higher. So you can treat the first recurrence with the same regimen as with which you treated the original episode, though I usually, if they had metronidazole for the initial episode, I'll usually go to vancomycin for the first recurrence. The second recurrence is treated with pulsed or tapering course of vancomycin, and there's all these tapers out there, and people bring in calendars and have to write, you know, we're going to QOD and dropping the dose as you go along, and that's very complicated, actually, and kind of easy for the patients to get confused. So one of the things in the ACG guidelines is going 125 milligrams 4 times a day for 10 days, so it's a regular 10-day course of QID vanco, and then doing a pulse dose regimen where they just take one dose of 125 milligrams every 3 days for 10 doses, which extends things out about another 4 weeks. And that's actually a little bit easier for patients. And you also want to reassess the diagnosis, and this is really important. About 25% of the patients referred to our center for recurrent C. difficile infection actually don't have recurrent C. difficile infection. We found all kinds of things, but one of the most common ones is post-infectious irritable bowel, and they're colonized with C. diff. The C. diff PCR doesn't test for the toxin itself, it tests for the gene that codes the toxin, so patients can remain colonized for months after a successful course of therapy. One little clue is that these patients usually don't respond to courses of vancomycin. They say they feel the same whether they're on vanco or off vanco, which you would expect them to get better if their symptoms were due to C. diff. Also, the symptoms can be kind of intermittent and non-progressive. They'll have good days and they'll have bad days. They usually don't have nocturnal symptoms. They don't get progressively sicker off vancomycin. And those patients can be treated with fiber, dietary changes, probiotics, reassurance, and so forth. Oops, backwards. So what other therapies are out there? Sorry, this is a little small font, but fidaxomicin, its shtick is that it selectively eradicates C. diff. It has less disruption of normal gut flora, because we know vancomycin very widely affects other gram-positives in the colon. And in a non-inferiority study that was published in the New England Journal in 2011, it was shown to be as effective as vancomycin in treatment of an initial C. diff infection. They did show in one subpopulation of patients with the non-NAP1 strain, that there was decreased recurrence of C. diff at 25 days, but they did not get labeling for that indication, and it's still very expensive. It's about $2,000 for a 10-day course, and the role in multiply recurrent disease is not really yet well established. You'll see often this rifaximin chaser, where people will complete a vancomycin course and then take another 2 weeks, 10 days to 2 weeks of rifaximin. This was published in a couple of case series and is often used, but I've rarely seen it be very effective. There's very limited evidence in recurrent disease, certainly no placebo-controlled trials. I do find one population where it's been helpful are people with cirrhosis who may require rifaximin anyway for hepatic encephalopathy and are also having recurrences. I've found that we've been able to stop recurrences in some of those patients just with the kind of double duty rifaximin. And then lastly, the toxin binders. This is the cholestyramine that people often give to calm down the diarrhea. These are not effective for C. diff, and they can actually bind vancomycin. I've seen someone come in with a symptomatic recurrence while on vancomycin because they were taking cholestyramine at the same time, so I urge you not to do that. So how about probiotics for treatment of C. diff infection? So we know probiotics are these good microorganisms that are going to come in and restore this microbial balance. And it is important to remember that there have been case reports of fungemia and bacteremia in immunocompromised and critically ill patients. So it's kind of one of my pet peeves to walk in the intensive care unit and see somebody intubated and on pressors and who needs to go to surgery and they're giving them lactobacillus or something. It's really not indicated. The only probiotic that has any real positive evidence for treatment of C. diff is Saccharomyces boulardii. It's a non-pathogenic yeast. It may have some role in inactivating the toxin receptors. And a single study showed that there was decreased recurrence when it was used in combination with high-dose vancomycin. And then more recently, there was an interesting paper by Johan Bakken out of Minnesota where he added kefir, and it was quite a bit of kefir. It was about 5 ounces of kefir 3 times a day, along with tapering doses of metronidazole and vancomycin. And he showed that he resolved recurrent C. difficile as effectively as fecal transplant with this regimen. I've used it a couple of times. I've had success once. Now, a different story. How about probiotics for prevention of C. difficile infection in the first place? This is a meta-analysis. It was a Cochrane review of 23 randomized controlled trials involving over 4,000 patients. And they did show that use of probiotics decreased the incidence of C. difficile infection significantly. It was about a 2% incidence in the probiotic group versus about a 5.5% incidence in the control group. And based on that, they do feel that it is effective in prevention with a number needed to treat of about 29 to prevent one case of C. diff. This was a larger multi-center randomized controlled trial. It was conducted in the United Kingdom. It also was looking at probiotics for prevention of C. diff infection. And they took a very high-risk group of hospitalized patients over 65 years old who were being exposed to antibiotics and treated them with a high-dose multi-strain probiotic for 21 days or with a placebo. And this studied nearly 3,000 patients. perhaps the efforts at antibiotic stewardship and so forth in the United Kingdom were too successful. They had a very low incidence of C. diff in the population of about 1%. And probably because of that, they didn't show that there were significant differences in incidence of C. diff between probiotics and controls. What I do is any patients who have come to me and been suffering from recurrent C. diff, I usually put them on probiotics. Anyone who ultimately recovers from C. diff infection, I do recommend to them that any time they go to the pharmacy to pick up an antibiotic for UTI or any other indication, they should pick up a probiotic at the same time, take it a different time of day, and maybe extend it for another 2 weeks to a month beyond the course of antibiotics. And this makes patients, especially who've already had C. diff before and have kind of a PTSD about getting C. diff again, it makes them feel proactive that they're actually doing something. And I do not use it in immunocompromised or acutely ill patients. So fecal microbiota transplantation. This is where we administer feces that contain that entire spectrum of a healthy gut microbial community to repopulate colonization with these beneficial flora. And it's thought to work by restoring diversity of microorganisms and these beneficial anaerobes, as well as butyrate-producing bacteria. And it works by both engrafting new species from the donor to the recipient, as well as augmentation of species that are present in the recipient, but at only very low amounts prior to FMT. And there's been a real rapid growth of FMT lately. And most recent systematic review published last year of over 500 patients treated showed nearly 90% experienced clinical resolution after FMT for C. difficile with no serious adverse events reported, though certainly there's probably underreporting bias there. The first randomized controlled trial was published in the New England Journal in 2013. This got a lot of press, and really since that time we've seen a huge growth in people applying FMT clinically in their practice. In this Dutch study, they took patients who had suffered at least one recurrence of C. diff and treated them either with a short course of vancomycin followed by a nasoduodenal infusion of donor stool, or with just vancomycin alone, or with vancomycin plus a bowel prep. And they showed that recurrence was 81% after a first infusion of donor stools, was around 20% after a first infusion of donor stools versus 70% in patients who had been treated with vancomycin. So they found it was highly effective. After a second FMT in those patients who failed to respond, 94% achieved cure. And so their safety monitoring board actually stopped the study early at the interim analysis because it was felt to be unethical to continue to give people this inferior treatment of this vancomycin. So FMT is actually pretty easy when you think about it. You have to identify and screen a donor, collect and prepare the material somehow, and then administer this prepared material into the patient. But each of these steps has a lot of questions and various ways that you can approach it, and people sometimes get confused, and when they're looking to start, you know, doing FMT, where do you start? So first, donor selection. Patients can pick an intimate partner, family member, or a friend, but they don't necessarily have to be related. There's really no evidence that using a related donor has any benefit whatsoever. At our center, we made use of volunteer donors for a study that we recently conducted, and that worked well. The donors should be healthy. We actually exclude donors with any conditions that might even theoretically be transmitted by gut microbiota, including inflammatory bowel disease, autoimmune conditions, any history of malignancy, obesity, and features of the metabolic syndrome. They also have to be low risk. We administer the questionnaire that you do when you go to the blood bank to donate blood. It's called the AABBDHQ, and it asks questions about health risk behaviors, travel, and those kinds of things. And anyone with high risk behaviors for blood donation are not permitted to donate stool. And lastly, very importantly, the donors should not have received antibiotics for at least 90 days prior to the planned FMT. I've had failed FMT referred to me in a donor who had just taken clindamycin, so probably not an optimal donor there. And then I added to the slide donor and recipient screening because it's important we actually do screen the recipients for HIV, viral hepatitis, and syphilis prior to FMT, and that's more of a risk management issue, but I have found patients who had hepatitis C and didn't know it or were Hep B core positive, and it's good to document that prior to infusing an experimental investigational agent into them. These highlighted testing is what is recommended as very minimal testing that needs to be done on donors. And that includes the same serologic testing as you would do on the recipient, as well as stool testing for routine bacterial culture, ova and parasites, and C. diff. At our institution, they won't run ova and parasites. They only do giardia. So we have to make a special request that that gets done. For our study that we recently completed, the FDA suggested adding all of these organisms to the battery of tests, which increased the complexity and the cost a lot. And finally, these are just other centers and what other people are doing and in the published literature, other organisms that you can test for. And this isn't meant to be a comprehensive list of everything that you need to do to test your donors. And I think you may use different testing depending on the region of the country where you're living and what organisms might be endemic. So you administer this by choosing a dose of 100 to 350 to 100 grams of stool. It can be given as single versus multiple treatments. It's diluted in either saline or water, mixed and filtered, and then infused either by nasal duodenal, nasogastric tube, or endoscopic administration by lower upper endoscopy, and some have given it as retention enemas. To make things easier, Open Biome, who many of you have heard of, have a stool bank. They're located outside of Cambridge. It's a nonprofit organization. You are the clinician, you need stool. Instead of having to find a donor and do all that screening yourself, you place a call to Open Biome and order. Meanwhile, behind the scenes, they're doing all of that donor assessment and donor screening. Less than 5% actually pass their rigorous screening. They quarantine every dose for 60 days until donors can be retreated and maintain safety aliquots of every dose. They then send out the stool frozen, which is thawed for use, and the clinician performs the FMT. So per the FDA, you may administer FMT to treat C. diff infection not responding to standard therapies. You must provide informed consent, stating that FMT is investigational and discussing potential risks. There are real risks, such as transmission of infection or risks of the procedure used to administer FMT, but also theoretical risks of altering the microbiome and perhaps increasing risk of future disease in these patients. We won't be doing fresh stool FMT much longer. I'd anticipate probably within the next 3 years there may be a product on the market. Rebiotics, a company, has basically made a microbiota suspension, which is human stool. They're in phase 2B clinical trials and have gotten fast track status from the FDA to get this through. Encapsulated projects, this is Tom Louis in Calgary, and he treated 27 patients successfully with fresh stool that was encapsulated. There was another study using frozen FMT capsules that came out last year by Libby Homan at MGH, and they also had resolution of C. diff infection with use of these orally administered products. And lastly, Series 109. This is sort of a distilled version of FMT. They've isolated what they believe are the essential organisms for a successful FMT. These are spore-forming clostridial, non-C. diff clostridials. And in their phase 1-2 study, of 30 patients, 29 reached the 8-week endpoint free of recurrent C. diff infection, and another phase 2 study, multi-center, is underway right now. So the key points today, the epidemiology of C. difficile infection is changing. We're seeing more C. diff in previously low-risk populations. The algorithms for management differ depending on the severity of disease. And FMT is the most effective therapy for recurrent disease, so if you're not doing it already, I encourage you to bring it back to your practice, and really, it's changed my life. It's been a really great thing to be able to do for these patients who are suffering. So thank you very much.